Hey guys, welcome to Traditional Bow Hunting Wilderness Podcast. This is Jason Samkovic. Today we're going to be talking about this right here, Jeep Cherokee Trailhawk, and why so many people love this thing. What makes it so great? So, for example, we have 2020 Jeep Grand Cherokee Trailhawk model. Now, mine has got a little bit of mods done to it, nothing too crazy, but I did put a 1.5 inch lift on this, so it is 1.5 inches higher, and I put bigger tires on there. These are still the stock rims, but I did put bigger Falcon tires on this. If you guys have followed me, you know I use this thing in the woods all the time, and that's what I bought it for. But so many people love this vehicle. So many people think of this vehicle here, this Cherokee Trailhawk, is the ultimate. There's good reason for that. There's a great reasons, probably 7-8 of them, as to why it's one of the best sellers and one of the most capable off-road vehicles there is. And we're going to break them down and cover it, because I'll tell you what, this Cherokee Trailhawk right here will outdo this truck in the woods 10 times over. Matter of fact, I can honestly say that of every vehicle I have owned, other than my Jeep Wrangler that we had, it was lifted and had 35s on there and all that stuff too, but other than that vehicle, this is by far the most capable off-road vehicle I've ever owned. But it's got so much more benefits than that. Let's break them down a little bit here. First of all, price. Okay, price is one factor in here. In its class, this is very affordable. Okay, this is a very affordable yet so capable. But money-wise, it's very affordable. In the fact that if you play your cards right and you do things right, you know, there's no reason you can't get this in a Trailhawk for under $30,000 brand new buying it. And I have a course linked below for that. I've talked about it in other things. The Save Thousands course will teach you how to do that. Everything I buy, I get it the tremendously incredible deals on. And this is no different. Even this truck, our Ram 2500 right here, you know, this is a $68,000 truck, and I paid $51,500 for it. So like I said, the deals are out there. The deals are there to be made. And but price wise, even without getting the deals, just looking at the MSRP numbers, this one is an incredible steal for what you get for it. And this has got off-road capabilities that nothing else in this class has that we'll cover, but it's a great price. Okay, that's a tremendous feature right there. The price is absolutely phenomenal. So what you get with it though is you get a lot of room. You know, you get a nice leather interior. Mine is dirty. I just washed the outside. I haven't got the inside yet. But you get very nice interior set up in here. Leather seats, nice labeling in them. I mean, they're quality. And they're, see this arch, all this support in here? They are incredibly comfortable seats. Now, this vehicle's been, it's been to Missouri twice, it's been to Georgia twice. We've done some long distance driving, and I don't ever stop and get a hotel, so we drive straight through with this stuff. So this has done 18-hour long road trips, and it's very, very comfortable. Actually, I would say it's the second most comfortable vehicle I've ever done that trip in, that Georgia trip. I've done it in 7 vehicles now. First one would be this one. This Ram here wins. It's more comfortable just because of your upright position of being in a truck, but with that said, this Cherokee is way more comfortable than my F-150s ever were. This is just really comfortable seats. This one here, in here, you don't ever feel your butt going numb on you or your tailbone starting to hurt or anything. Same with this one. Some of the other vehicles we've used and made that trip in, including my daughter's old Compass, which is sitting over there behind the trees back there. You can see it, but we just took her old Compass down there. You can see it sitting right there, but that was by far the most uncomfortable vehicle that we've ever taken on that trip. I can't tell why my phone is not zooming here, but that one right there, the worst. I mean, that was brutal. So it doesn't matter, but comfort wise, I would put this Cherokee Trailhawk as number 2 spot. I mean, this thing was amazing. Absolutely great for that kind of trip. But you do get a lot of good interior features, a lot of nice stuff in there. You got good room in here. The back seats give you tremendous room. Mine is set up right now. I'll actually open the back hatch so you can take a look at this stuff here. But you can see, you have a lot of room back here. I can actually sleep back here, and I've done that twice now, where I've taken this on hunting trips, and I can actually have all my gear on this side. With these seats down, I can lay right there. I can put my pillow right at the edge of that. I usually have my backpack stuck between a seat and there, so it fills that gap, and I put my head right on there. My feet do not make it to the end of this. I can actually lay in here and sleep completely stretched out in the back end of this, which is pretty nice, too. So you do get the full drop-down capability. I have rugs or just towels on here right now, because again, I carry so much crap back here all the time. But it is a fantastic, gives you a lot of room. And we've even camped in this for a night where we pulled this and backed it right up next to the lake, and that was our view. And we slept right back here. And it has this slight angle to it, which makes it really comfortable to sleep on too when it's in this position. So it's a really nice setup. You do got full seats here. You know, here's your back seats. You got two of them. You do got flip down armrests, you know, blah, 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 stuff that you could go through and see anywhere real easy. Again, we got to clean it. But you do got a tremendous amount of room back here, even for people to sit in here. So it's a good setup. Real nice features. USB ports, blah, blah, blah. You go through all that stuff. We're here to talk about the main things about it here that, really make it a difference, make a difference to it. But back end space, tremendous. Tie downs everywhere you want them. They think there's four in here, but it has tie downs all over here, so you can secure your gear and lock it into place. The back end is an awesome feature back here too, I like, which is where your spare tire carrier goes, but it gives you so much room. Look at all the stuff I have in here. Plus, I have a full size, not a donut. That's a full size spare, but you can see, all I told you, I take this thing off road all the time. So I have all this gear in here, and it all fits underneath this, you know, my ledge here like that too. So that's fantastic. They give you tremendous, absolutely tremendous amount of space in here to be able to store stuff. Plus, you got a couple of pockets that you can see are deep, and I have a lot of stuff in them down here. You got very good deep pockets that drop right down in here. I don't remember why I have that wrench in here, but I'm gonna have to figure that out. But you do got an awesome on both sides. So you got storage there, tie downs there. You got same thing over here, all kinds of storage over here on this side as well too. Same deep pockets here with things in it. Another 12 volt right there, so if you want to hook things up. So you got a lot of options in the back of this thing as far as setting it up. So that's your interior, your stuff that if I don't go through that, somebody's gonna yell at me. Now for the important things. Okay, what makes this thing such a great vehicle? Well, it's the capability of it. It is very comfortable on the road, very quiet to drive, very, very good, great road on-road manners, but it has so much off-road capability as well, too. Today, we live in a world where families are adventuring more and more. People are hunting, and maybe people don't want to have to hunt out of a pickup truck like that, things of that nature. So there's this SUV off-road segment is growing tremendously, and with good reason. There's a lot of benefits. Like I said, this vehicle here is way more capable off-road than that truck is, no doubt, hands down. Way more capable than pretty much any vehicle I've had, for reasons, again, we're going to talk about. But what do you get with this that makes it that way? Well, first of all, look at the wheelbase on this too, which is a great thing. You get all that interior space, which is a lot, but you also have this shorter wheelbase. If you were to pull this up, if I were to put that front wheel on that crack in the cement there, if you look at the distances between these, you could probably fit the tires between in this one little section between that crack and that crack right there and fit this in here. That's very important because that gives you break over angle. Okay, so when you're coming out of holes or going up hills or down hills or anything like that, you get that break over angle right in the middle, which means that when your front wheel drops into a hole, if your back wheels are too long, then you're going to scrape and hang up on the middle of your frame here and vice versa. So that becomes very important. This thing comes with 8.7 or 8.8 inches of ground clearance stock. Right now, we would be about 2 inches taller than that on my particular setup with the lift and the tires. But you get that breakover angle comes from the wheelbase. Okay, the distance from the wheel here to the wheel there. And as you can see, this one is small enough that you could fit that on one block of cement right there, one pad. If you look at, for example, let's look at my Ram, which is also a short bed Ram, but look at how this is. I mean, we're almost at that line, but yet look at how far back behind us you are. Okay, now what that means is that means when that front wheel comes out of a hole, or goes into a hole, we're going to drag somewhere in here because we got so far for that back wheel to get there. So that distance in there is tremendous. That's your wheelbase distance. That's one thing that makes this a great off-roader. The other thing is your approach angles, okay? Approach angle is this angle from here to here. Look at how steep that angle is. So if I were to pull up to a hill that steep, I could climb that without screwing up the front of my vehicle. That approach angle right there from the tires up is huge on this. That lets me drop into big holes, come up steep inclines, and not worry about getting stuck on my front end. Where look at the Ram. Look at how that has all that stuff. If you were to look at that approach angle and go from here, it's not bad. It's still really good, especially how we got it set up. But now, well, here's a better example. Let's look at also the rear approach angle, and then we'll go over and look at that. But on the rear, you go from here, and you come out. Look at that angle. Now, forget the trailer hitch, but take that up. You got a pretty good angle on there. So you got very good approach and departure angles. Looking at something like this compass, you will see the difference on here. When you start talking about these things, if you look at the front of this, the approach angle, now this is pretty good rear approach angle on this, but the front, look at the front here. You try to come up out of this and you come from that front tire, you got nothing. Look at how low that angle is versus the angle like this that was on the Cherokee Trailhawk. So that approach angle in the front is a completely different deal here. So it's gives you very good off-road capability to get in and out of holes. And I know a lot of people think that, well, approach angle only matters when you're in the mountains or in the hills or things like that. That is 100% false. Approach angle is everything, from the fact that when you even drop into a rut or a hole, if you drop in nose first and you don't have that approach angle, you're going to rip the whole front of your car off. My F-150s, this valance that you see under here, was ripped off many times on my F-150s because of not having enough approach angle. This, that approach angle is so incredibly perfect that you'd never have to worry about that. I mean, it holds up incredible. So, I mean, it gives you good value right there for off-road capabilities, is that approach and departure and the breakover angle in the middle. Those are hard to beat. Next one, ground clearance. Like I said, you get 8.8 or whatever it is, or 8.5 or 8.7 inches of ground clearance in a stock one, mine being 2 inches higher than that. But That ground clearance is tremendous, but it also gives you, when you buy the Trailhawk model, you get tremendous skid plates underneath this whole thing. So if we come here and look, sorry, I hit the button on there and cancel it, but if you look at the skid plates on this thing, look at all that. You know, so protected all over underneath this whole car, which is very, very nice. Give you a comparison. If you look at underneath my Ram, look at how exposed all this stuff is that you can hang up on stumps, branches, everything like that. Look at everything in here, okay? So it's nice to have all that skid plate underneath that Cherokee. And so what it's going to do is it's going to float basically over top of everything. It's not going to hang up on things, and it's going to be protected from rocks, stumps. You know, any dragging you're doing is going to be much smoother. So if you do bottom out the middle of this and you get it stuck, you're going to be able to roll. You know, your tires will have a better chance of pulling you off of whatever obstacle you're on, because you have that smooth skid plates all the way through that thing like that. So it's a fantastic setup with the skid plate features on there. So that's an important one. Another one, tow hooks, front and rear. Okay, pulling from a trailer hitch is a horrible idea. You never want to do that because you can rip this hitch right off. They're not designed for that. But having a dedicated rear tow hook on there, fantastic. I don't even have that on the back of my Ram. Okay, I have to use an insert that plugs into here that's got a shackle that mounts on there that I keep inside this truck. But I don't even have a tow hook place on the back of that Ram, but yet I do on this right there. And it's nice and simple to hook right onto and solid. It's a great tow hook there. And I have two on the front, which is fantastic as well too. Two tow hooks right there. They make them red, which is kind of nice, but two good red tow hooks on the front of that too. So you have the recovery capability, which is nice. Now, the big stuff that matters, what makes this such a great adventure, great off-road, great hunting vehicle, great anything like that in the woods, is that we have a couple of features. One is we have rear low, okay? An actual dedicated low drive in this, all right? A four-wheel drive low function in this. Now, it's all-wheel drive all the time, which makes it so nice for people on the road. Where with this truck, when I'm going down the road in the wintertime, if it starts snowing out, I have to actually engage four-wheel drive on this and put it in there. And I have to decide when to do that. Otherwise, I could slip and lose it. This is all time. It's basically front wheel drive, but it's always got that four wheel drive, that all wheel drive setup ready to roll if it needs it. So if it senses any slippage, it automatically kicks in. Where this, if I didn't already kick it in, I could slip and lose it. This one does it automatically. So what's really nice about that is in the woods, I don't even, most of the time when we're running trails and two tracks and power lines, I don't even engage four-wheel drive. I just know it's going to do it for me when it needs it anyway. Where this one, as soon as we pull off the pavement, it goes into four-wheel drive immediately. I have to manually do that. So it's got a lot of features there, but a four-wheel drive low range is pretty much not something that's very common on these smaller off-road SUVs, especially in this class. Having that four-wheel drive low really gives you that power to crawl out and be very controlled when you're using it and really get that engine power to the wheels at that crawl ratio. The crawl ratio in this is actually better than what it is in a Jeep Wrangler. The thing is incredible with its capabilities and the power that you get in four-wheel drive low. And then to top it off, we have what's called locking rear differentials in this. Okay, we have rear wheel lockers. What that means is that the back two wheels, if I put that in four low and then I hit the differential locks, both rear wheels have equal power to spin. Now understand that, because this is an interesting one, because many vehicles don't have this, and this is the only vehicle I've had that does not have rear lockers, and I thought, no, not a big deal. Well, it's a big deal. It's a really big deal, and I won't ever buy a vehicle without them again, but you have to buy them that way. So, like, if you're looking at F-150s, you're looking at an FX4 package to get that, or you need to buy the locking rear diff. To Toyota, Tacomas, you got to get into the TRDs, or you have to buy it as an add-on option. Even the Jeep Wranglers, they don't even all come with it. So that rear locker is essential. That is a very big deal. And when you get into like a Jeep Rubicon, you get front and rear lockers. So, but rear lockers are important. To get them in a Ram truck, you need to go to their off-road package. Okay, just like you have to go to an FX4 package or a Sport package with the add-on in Ford. It's important. Well, the Trailhawk package, you get that rear locking differential. So what happens, looking at this one, if I get this truck stuck, okay, if I'm stuck in the mud, for example, and I got four-wheel drive engaged, if these two wheels, say it's muddy here and I got a little harder ground over there, if these two are stuck in the mud, they're going to continue to spin and no traction is going to the other side. So even though I have four-wheel drive vehicle, really only two-wheel drives or two tires spin. So in a, how to put that simple terms here, in a two-wheel drive vehicle is really only one wheel drive when it's in two-wheel drive mode, because only one wheel, whichever one has got the slipperiest or the ease of braking free, is the one that actually drives the vehicle. When you go to four-wheel drive, you're still only a two-wheel drive vehicle for most of them. One wheel in the front, one wheel in the back, even though it's considered four-wheel drive. Same with this. Only one wheel in the back and one wheel in the front. When they brake free, they will spin. So in this, in the front end, if I have this stuck in the mud or I'm trying to get through sand or whatever, if this wheel starts to brake free before the other one, all the power goes to this wheel, and that wheel pretty much, for the most part, generally speaking, becomes useless and dead, and this one just sits here and spins, and we're stuck, okay, because that's just the way they work. They have to be an open differential for on the roads and on pavement for the wheels to turn and not bind up and things to happen. It has to be that way. But so, like I said, all vehicles are that way. So if this gets stuck and this wheel breaks free, this is the one it spins. If I were to jam a traction board under that wheel and try and get it to go, and this one gets traction, but then the other one spins, this one stops spinning, and the other one just spins freely. That's why you have to carry two traction mats, two traction boards, two, because you need to equalize that out on most four-wheel drive systems. When you have locking differentials, you hit a button inside there, and then what happens is now this wheel and the other side both will work. Even if this one breaks free, the other one still has transfer equal, let's just call it 50-50 power. So if this one starts spinning, the other one is still doing its job and getting you out over there. So that's tremendous. So with a locking rear differential, you are basically taking what would be a two-wheel vehicle, two-wheel powered vehicle in four-wheel drive mode. Hope that makes sense, because when you're stuck, we're not talking everyday driving, but when you're stuck, it's only one front wheel that can work for you and only one rear wheel that can work for you. You hit a button in there and now you have three wheels that are working for you, one in the front and two in the rear when you're stuck and those wheels are spinning. So having that locking rear differential gives you twice the power capability to get yourself unstuck in the back. And it also means that I can put a traction board, if this is a wheel that's the one that's the problem, I can put a traction board underneath here and get this wheel to actually climb out on it. But if the other one's still spinning, it doesn't matter. This one keeps the power ratio of 50-50-ish to it. So the rear locker essentially takes this four-wheel drive stuck. When you are stuck in a hole and you are in four-wheel drive, you only get two wheels that do the work in this vehicle. Where in this one, same scenario, I get three wheels to do the work. Two rears because I can lock them, plus the one in the front. So lockers are fantastic. This is a very important feature that you get, and very few have it. Very few off-road or SUVs are going to give you a dedicated four low, and that they're going to give you an actual rear locker. Now, a lot of them give you sport mode, snow mode, mud mode. I'll tell you what, I don't ever use any of those myself personally. I never have. I didn't use them in my other one, my Renegade. I don't use them. But they're there if you want them, and that's all fine and dandy. And a lot of, manufacturers give you that, but they do not give you the four low and the rear locker, which is absolutely phenomenal. And, I'd have to look it up, and I did, and I can't remember, but even water fording on this, I want to say that it's 20-something inches, 20 to 22 inches in stock form of water fording capabilities. That's what, I'm guessing that that's going to be about right here, you know, about that far when you think about that. Well, those are 32, so you're probably talking about this deep of water fording capabilities on this vehicle that you can go through before you have to mess with anything. The reason they give you that is because all of the venting for your differentials, your transmission, the air intake, all these things that require air are raised up high enough that you get very good water crossing capabilities with this that are higher than pretty much anything else in its class or gives you any options for. So it is a true off-road capable machine here. There is no doubt about it. This thing here will, I take this places that this truck could never go. And again, we're not just talking, you know, I'm not talking about four-wheel drive parks and things like that. I'm talking about, you know, Michigan, in the woods in northern Michigan, but also down in Georgia. Georgia's all swamp. When Georgia's swamp and sand. And I'll tell you what, I mean, you want to talk about some rough stuff. I mean, there's a reason that when you drive through parts of Georgia, pretty much every truck you see has got mud tires on it, because it's brutal down there. This little Jeep goes through everything. That truck there, that is a nightmare in some of those spots, especially without the rear locker. Now, I get through it, and I've been stuck in it twice and had to use, but I have methods to get me out of it. But if I had a choice, this one all day long off-road. Plus, the suspension is so much softer, such a comfortable, easy ride. So it's got everything going for it. There's not anything that you're missing. And when it comes to the ability to really adventure out in this thing, you get some nice advantages, too, that people don't think about. The roof racks, obviously, but they're good quality roof racks, okay? They let you put these in positions anywhere you want them for your cross rails, where, again, not to keep going back and forth, but if you come over here and look at my daughter's compass, she just got her new Toyota RAV4, so I'm just using this one for another 2 months to eat the miles up on it before we turn it in. And but if you look at here on her cross rails, hey, they're enclosed. See, they're sealed. And you can see those bolt holes over there. There are only two positions or three positions that you can put the cross rails on here. You have no other choice. They have to be right into those bolt holes that are right over there on that side. See here, bring you in. Right there, those bolt holes, those are where the cross rails have to go in this. So it's kind of a downside that you are limited to where you can put them on here. Where on that Cherokee, you can put those rails any place you want them to be on there. So what's nice about that is if you don't want to use them in that mode they're in right there, you can adjust them forward, backwards, move them around. So it's nice they give you this full open rail. Is a really nice feature. Plus, I can now tie to this, okay? Where on hers, on the other ones, when they're solid, you cannot. You have to tie to these. I don't want to tie to these. These are on there, but I don't want to have to tie onto these with my canoe or kayak or anything up here. I want to be able to tie to these rails. So the nice open rails are a nice bonus that they give you. Next one is the height of the trailer hitch. Now, a lot of people don't think about this, okay? They don't put two and two together. That trailer hitch is so high off the ground. I know the angle of the camera doesn't really show you. Same with, like, showing you underneath or the ground clearance. It doesn't really put it into true perspective here for you. But that hitch is pretty high off the ground. I mean, it's coming out of there. I mean, those are 30, whatever they are, 32-inch tires or whatever. Look at, I mean, you're talking, you know, 28 inches or something to that hitch height. Look at how low I have to run. I had to go with a drop hitch trailer hitch. I couldn't use a standard one to get that ball down that far below that point on that trailer. And that was done on purpose that it comes out and has to. But this trailer that I have this set up to pull is the same exact trailer sitting right over there that I'm running on this one. Look at on this huge diesel. Okay. I'm down in hole slot number three. I'm in hole slot, yeah, number three on that one. I'm in hole slot number two on this one. So it just goes to show you how high they put that hitch. Why does that matter? Well, if you want to put a cargo rack on the back of this, which I will show you a video of, I'll put a little inset or a screenshot of it, but you can put a hitch carrier rack on here, and that hitch carrier rack is going to be high enough off the ground where on many cars, the hitch is underneath here, and it comes out, so now your hitch carrier has no angle or no height under it. Remember we were talking about this angle right here? For going up and down, coming out of hills and off-roading. If that hitch was down here and you had a big basket on here, you're going to hit that basket on the ground. When you go up in the front, you're going to hit that and bend that basket and break things. Here they put the hitch so high up that that basket is on there. And I will inset a picture of it for you. But you get that height out of that basket that's going to make all the difference for you. As a matter of fact, I'll go grab it right now. All right, we have that hitch rack on there. By the way, if you guys are looking for an amazing hitch rack, I will put a link to this one down below. And I've done videos on it. But this one is all aluminum. 25 pounds, yet holds a tremendous amount of weight. It's 450 pounds or whatever, but this thing is incredible and lightweight. Best hitch carrier I've ever used. But if you look at that, look at the height we have of that hitch rack. So if the front of this vehicle starts to go up, or you know, you're coming, you go into a hole and then you go to come out and the back end drops in, you have tremendous height. So I was able to run this Jeep in Georgia through the backwoods out there hunting down there through some of the worst stuff you could ever imagine, where I had to keep this thing in four-wheel drive, you know, a couple times running the diff locks. But I mean, we're talking nasty, rutted out, miserable stuff. And I was okay with this hitch rack because of how high they put that hitch on there. That means that I don't have to worry about this hitting the ground and then bending, which is tremendous. So you get a lot of capability with this. And now what else is nice, even with a huge cooler, like that one you see there, that massive huge cooler, that's the whole size of this whole thing with that on there, I can still open, and I've done videos of it, I'll show you, I'll link them in here, but I can still open the back end with that on here. So you get a tremendous amount of capability for your adventuring with a vehicle like this. Now, yes, you can put a hitch rack on pretty much any vehicle, but do they sit that high? Do they give you that kind of clearance and capability? That's pretty impressive. Now, also, these hitch carriers, These are fantastic too. And I got these from Amazon. I'll put a link down below for you, but they're under 50 bucks and they are slide adjustable. So I can keep this here if I want it, put it up front. I can move them back here and put both of them together back here for storage if I don't want to. Simple Allen key, and they are lockable. These things are amazing for $50. They are straight up incredible. I will have a link down below for them, and I have done a video review on them too, but they are fantastic. But so what you get with this Cherokee Trailhawk is you get an affordable, very capable off-roader with plenty of room for your family and for weekend trips and camping trips and extensions. You can even put a rooftop tent on top of this if you want. A lot of guys are doing it where it's actually a whole tent system on there that flips out, ladder goes up to it. It's a rooftop tent, but you can do so many things with this vehicle, and it has enough room for you, for all your gear, for your family, for hunting. We put our jet sleds right inside of there to put our animals in. I've done videos on that as well too, on them and setting them up for hunting. But I mean, I can slide my jet sled right in there with deer in it, with pigs in it, whatever I want, have it all so that there's no blood or anything that gets in here. Just make makes life really easy. I know some of you guys are going to be disgusted with the fact that I hunt, but understand the channel you're watching and keep in mind that we eat everything we get, and that's where we get all of our food from, 100% natural. But this vehicle, endless capabilities, very, very solid, very affordable, and has features that no other vehicles anywhere near its capability or price range can even compare to when it comes to off-roading. So that's the reason that everybody loves it. And it gets good gas mileage. I don't know what gas mileage this got before I did the lift and tires, because I did them pretty quick on this thing. The lift was only like $150 for the lift, and it took like 2 hours to put on. So it was very easy, very simple, does not void your warranty, nothing crazy about it. And then I put the bigger tires on it. But even now with this setup like this, without the roof racks, okay, with the roof racks, I'm assuming they're going to, they probably knock down. I haven't been on the highway with these on there yet because I take them off when we do the trips. And around town, they don't matter. But without those two crossbars on there, I'm still getting 21 miles a gallon with this thing running down the road. That's pretty impressive with a 1.5-inch lift and those bigger tires on there. So I don't know what they get stock. There's probably other videos that show you. When I bought this, I did a lot of research like you're doing right now watching this video. I watched hundreds of videos on this. A lot of the stuff you're going to see is going to be off-roading with this thing, and the capabilities of this thing will blow your mind. This thing is an absolute beast in the woods, and just incredible adventure vehicle, and does it all, and it does it all for a very dirt cheap price. So you cannot argue with any of that. I hope you enjoyed this video. Hope you got a lot out of it, and thanks for watching. There'll be links down below for the roof rack on there, the crossbars, and for that basket on the back. And the hitch that I use with that drop-down capability, that hitch is very nice because it lets me, we sold our boat and stuff, but it was nice before because I could change that, like here, because this one's on. But for my work trailer, I can run it there. For my boat, I could pull that pin and raise it up or down for whatever we needed to haul. So it's a very versatile hitch. I put the same exact one right here, is the same exact hitch. It's gonna, is I set up and run right on this right here. And we get that same versatility of being able to quickly adjust for whatever trailer we're pulling so that we're pulling safely with the correct load rating and the correct angle and pitch on the trailer. So it gives you a lot of versatility, but just a fantastic vehicle. I just can't say enough good things about it. I straight up love this. And given a choice, which you guys have heard me say before, if you follow my stuff, given a choice to hunt out of this or to hunt out of this, I pick this every single day of the week without fail. This will go places that this cannot. This is so much easier. This thing is light enough. Another bonus to it. Lightweight. This thing just floats right over loose sand. You get any truck. You get a truck into sand. The trucks are light in the back, heavy in the front. And that front end just drops in and the back end just sits there and chop, 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 tries to get you out of the sand. And you got to fight with it. This thing here just floats right over top of it. In the mud, it's cakewalk easy. I have not got this stuck yet, but I have had to use the tracks. Well, so I guess I did get it stuck. But I carry tracks. I have the full-size tracks in a garage, which you've seen other videos on. But we also have a set of minis that I keep in here all the time. Right here, these are mini tracks right here. Set one up so you can see it, but mini tracks that I can take this, use it as a shovel if I want to. I carry a shovel, but I can stick that right under the tire in a jam and use that to climb out. Well, two of them fit perfectly
right here. You know, they drop right into this seat. Got to go in this way first, but they fit there. I have my full tool kit underneath there, which I've done videos on. So this, like I said, just a very functional, they're just black towels that are meant to keep that crap off of here, but apparently I need to clean this thing out sometime here. But like I said, such a great vehicle, just so much capability, so much, you know, I just can't say enough good things about it. So hopefully, if you're looking at one, this gives you some pointers and some things to think about. My opinion, best SUV in its size and class. I mean, don't get me wrong. I'd love to own a Toyota 4Runner. There's a lot of things that I'd like to own. That new Bronco, the new full-size Bronco looks really nice too. There's a lot of great vehicles out there. But for the price, function, capabilities, and all the benefits you get, I don't think you can beat this. I really don't, especially when you keep the price factor in here. This thing's just straight up amazing. See all those red dots? That's actually called iron. That comes from your brakes. It's brake dust. It's from your brakes and from other brakes as rotors on your brake pads in there. They leave this dust from every vehicle that's on the road, and it hits the road, and it's everywhere. And then your tires pick it up and throw it up, and you get these red spots like you're seeing all over. Okay, they look like rust. They're not, they are rust, but it's a spray of brake dust that is then turning into rust is what it is. And it's very hard to get rid of that by scrubbing and messing with it and things like that. So there is a better way to do that that gets rid of all that. Now usually it's white vehicles that you see it the most on, and it's usually up here in places where you get a lot of car spray, you know, from your tires. That's why it's what it is. It's basically you know, it's rail wash. It's basically coming off the brakes from all the cars. It lays on the ground. Your tires pick it up, spray it on there, and then it turns to rust instantly because it's just little bits of flakes of iron. But on a black car, you don't see it very much, so it's not so much a big deal. But there is a solution. Doesn't matter what brand you use, what it is. The key thing you're looking for is that it changes colors as it cleans. Changes colors as it clean, you know, color changing as it activates. This one is, you know, iron removing spray clay. This is Meguiar's. This is also Meguiar's. This one here was like 10 bucks for 24 ounces. This one I've had for a while. I think I paid about 20 bucks for 32 ounces. But, you know, Eagle One makes them. It doesn't matter what it is that you're getting, but this is the stuff. Now, this stuff does work on paint as well, too. It says it's safe for all paints and everything and wheels. But if you don't want to use that, you can go with straight up something like this as well, too. So you have options. But this stuff here, what we're going to do is we're just going to take this and we're going to spray it. So I'm going to turn this to spray. And you wash the car and then you spray it on the car and then you leave it. So if I spray this, and what it's going to do is it's going to turn that stuff to purple color, and then I'm going to wipe it. Okay, so it's not complicated. Just spray it so that it runs, as you can see I'm doing, and get it so it's on there. And then it's going to just do its thing and it'll start to turn it purple after a few minutes. So you don't want to let it dry. And then you're going to wipe it, and then you're just going to rinse it off. So it's real easy to do, but usually the back end is where it gets it the worst. So I'm going to put you a little wider here so you can see me doing this. Hang on here. So I'm just soaking this stuff, and it's going to just start to eat this stuff. It's going to just take that rust right off of there and get rid of that stuff. So that's kind of what you're trying to do, is just clean that all up and get rid of it. Now, typically, you should be washing your car first. I have not washed my car yet. All I did was just wet it down, but I'm going to be washing it, so I figured I might as well just put this stuff on here first. So I sprayed off all the loose stuff and just washed it, and then I'm just soaking this. So we'll soak it, and then I'll come back in 5 minutes. We'll see what it looks like. All right, so it's been about 2 minutes, but you can already see all that purple. That purple is iron that's been contaminated on there that is running off. That's not what's cool about the color changing effect of this, but you can see. So I don't have to work too hard. You can see it's already taking and breaking all that down, getting rid of that everywhere all along here. Look at it. Everywhere that your tires are going to spray up is where it's going to be the worst, but you can see it. See on the back where all that dust comes up and collects, and it's just eating all of that off of there and getting rid of it. So it just takes that, breaks it down, gets rid of it, and then you are, you know, pretty safe to go, and then you just clean it off. It's really a simple process, but look at how much of it was up in the words, in the lettering there. You can see it, but it just breaks it all down and gets rid of it for you. All right, let it sit for a while, and then you're just rinsing it off. You can see it coming off, and all there is to it. Just spray this stuff off. And then you're going to wipe it. Wipe it with a microfiber cloth. Get it off there. But that's it. Sweet and easy. Just don't let it dry on there. And it cleans it all out of there. So if we were to stop right here, for example, there, and we're grabbing a microfiber cloth here, like this, and just wiping that, you still got a little bit right there, one heavy one, we'll hit again, but that's it, basically cleans it off. Now I'm ready to wash it like I normally would, but that gets rid of all those spots on there. Just keeps that cleaned right off and gone, and makes life a lot easier. So there you go, quick little tip for you. Thanks for watching. Talk to you later. Bye.